Greetings, everybody. This is a German spy finally bringing you the next segment of the folklore playthrough. I cannot apologize enough for how late this has been. This has been sitting on my hard drive for about 6 weeks now, if not longer. And I first got bogged down with work, and then I've been sick. I've been sick for the past week and a half, and I'm still on the tail end of whatever it is that I have. So if I have to edit out a few coughs, I hope you'll all forgive me. I am picking up with Keats, and this is post-commentary. I've thought about it, and obviously apart from the fact that I can't do live commentary for this now, I've decided that I can't figure out any good way to do live commentary for a game like this that has so much downtime and so much tedious back and forth battling. So I'm going to stick with post-commentary for this game unless I figure out something else. And yeah, I guess let's get right back into it. So we've essentially picked up after Keats and Ellen have completed the first Netherworld, I guess, realm, the fairy realm. And so now we're resuming on chapter, I think it was 2, it just passed by on the screen. You'd think I would be paying attention, but I guess not. So now at this point, I'm just trying to figure out where to go next. So we're given a hint that we need to go find Ryan, or at least find some clues about him, because he's apparently dead. So Harriet's house, I could not remember where Harriet's house was, that clearly was not it. So I just ended up going around the village trying every door until I, on the second try, got lucky. Alright, so we've found out a couple of things. We found out that Ryan was killed on the day 17 years ago when something that we don't know about yet happened. We've found out that Ellen has been poking around, and we've also found out that we need to go talk to the pub owner, not the cat outside the pub, and see if he can provide us with anything. Thank you. So we've learned a little bit more interesting information about Ryan. He and the pubmaster were in the army together, and he was murdered in the graveyard behind the church. So now we're told where he used to live, and we have to go investigate his old house and see if we can turn anything up. So let's do that. Alright, where could the clue in here possibly be? Where would Ryan hide a clue? Oh, yeah, like, that's not totally obvious. Well, at least they didn't send us on a wild goose chase. And when we go to leave, who should show up but our good buddy Ellen? And conveniently, Ellen has the other half of the photo. And even more conveniently, either Ellen or Keats were carrying some tape or something because they put it back together, and we find out that this is a photo of a sick child and a doctor. So now we've established that the child in the photo was Herva, or Herv, or however the hell you pronounce that. I'm just going to go with Herv. Now, when I first played through this, or rather, when I played through this for this video, I couldn't remember at the time what consequence this choice has. I've since figured out that basically the choice you make here just determines which of these two ends up taking the photo to the henge and offering it. So I let Ellen take it here. That just is going to mean that during Ellen's chapter of this playthrough, she's going to be the one who offers this at the henge rather than Keats. So this basically just left me to figure out on my own where I had to go from here. Not really a major plot-changing choice. Now, stupidly, I chose to explore town a little bit more when there was really nothing else for me to find. I thought maybe Ellen might have some additional dialogue. She didn't. And this time, finally, I sensibly decide to advance the plot. And in spite of how simple the answer is, I still managed to go to the wrong place first. I'm jumping way ahead of myself in this case. This is basically the disadvantage of having played the game once before, is that I vaguely remember where I'm supposed to go, but I don't remember in what order, and so I end up coming here way earlier than I need to. And of course, there's nothing here. Thank you. Although, since there's a little bit of downtime now as I'm blindly wandering around, I should take this opportunity to explain that I have done some cutting in this video. After the initial recording, I ended up with about 2 hours of raw footage. I've managed to get it down just to 50 minutes, but there was a lot. The majority of it was just repetitive wandering around in the next section of the Netherworld, battling and doing karma releases, powering up my folks. So that much I've sliced that out and really condensed this. So there's a lot of plot though, so this is why it's 50 minutes still. But now I finally figured out where to go, and in fact Ellen is waiting for me. Yeah, how does Keats know what kind of place the afterworld is? So at this point, Ellen and Keats officially team up. Ellen invites Keats to go along with her to the church to figure out what the big deal is at the graveyard. And I'm just gonna shut up now and let you guys enjoy this random cutscene. And it looks for all the world like we've fallen down to hell. As a matter of fact, that assessment unfortunately isn't terribly far off base. So Balga has just kindly explained to us why we need to defeat the folklores in succession in order to continually access new sections of the Netherworld, or I guess just new Netherworlds entirely, because part of what he explained just now is that there are as many Netherworlds as there are stars, and this one is just based on a different idea that people had of what the realm of the dead is like. And I must say, this is a considerably less pleasant idea. This place doesn't look like really a very nice place to go when you die. And actually, I believe this is our first introduction to rebel denizens. These guys basically are supporters of Livan and Balga, whereas the fairies are obviously followers of the Fairy Lord. Speaking of which, here's a fairy right now! Oh, okay. This is how they retcon the sort of inconsistencies in time that you and Ellen complete alternate event or the same events here, rather. Basically, it's how they explain away how Keats shows up here and someone he talks to says, "Oh, Ellen's already been here," even though we haven't done Ellen's portion of this netherworld yet. So that's basically what that is. As you can see, the majority of the enemies here, or at least these first few enemies that we've run into, are kind of themed after World War I style soldiers, and that's pretty much par for the course throughout this place. Most of the enemies are kind of... They're like early 20th century soldier type, either actual kind of soldiers, or later on you start running into some equipment. There are also... Much later in the level, there are some mechs, if I remember correctly, and they're completely unrealistic for anything that would have existed in the first part of the 20th century, but they're kind of themed to look the early 19th, or rather early 20th century kind of theme. And as you can see here, there are some tank tread marks leading from the square off under the arch. There is actually an enemy that we'll fight later on that kind of resembles a tank, so folks can really take all forms. But yeah, lots of unpleasantness in Warcadia. This is a much more kind of confusing and challenging realm than the Fairy Realm. And here we have one of the mid-bosses. This guy is called Volcano, and he appears with some little minions that aren't really terribly challenging so much as they are just really kind of annoying. The gimmick here is you gotta take out the minions first, because if you don't, they will continually attack you and prevent you from being able to absorb bosses in. So just kind of systematically picking off the little guys. You do have to be careful not to get a cannon shot to the face, because he can do a lot of damage to you if you're careless. But really it's just a simple kind of strafe and attack strategy. Nothing really complicated or extremely difficult. And now that the minions are gone, we can safely unload on the big guy. And as you can see, all you really have to do is not get directly in front of him, and there's pretty much nothing he can do to you. Yeah, and for some reason, he appears to be a fire elemental enemy, but for some reason, he's apparently very susceptible to fire. So, here I am just roasting him and waiting for his id to destabilize. And there it is. So this method of absorption, this is the first time we see it. In this case, what you have to do is basically rock the controller back and forth as though you're strangling somebody, which I find kind of pleasing in a way. But that's basically it. So we've gotten Volcano's id, and now I'm going to equip it and give a brief demonstration. So we've got kind of a lame, stupid-looking fire attack, Hinky Punk, and now it appears we've gotten a much cooler-looking fire attack. So if I remember correctly, I think I just stick with this one and level him up and use him for the next couple of realms. So yeah, here he is. And of course, I'm going to show the explanation of him. I think I am. There we go. When it gets angry, both enemy and ally alike will be blasted indiscriminately with its flames. Ah, what a nice guy. So, what I've done here is... Oh, well, I guess first I've given a demonstration, but then after that, I went and released all of his karma, so I maxed him out, and I've cut that part out to save time, because that ended up taking something like 20 minutes. It was really pretty tedious. So I've cut that all out, and we're going to be picking up once I've finished. So here's the first karma release. And let's see what we have to do for the second. Defeat 10 Hawks, that's not too bad. Just pretty tedious. So skip past all that, and here's the second karma release. And what's the third? Defeat 10 folks with Volcano. Fair enough. Tedious, but not really very difficult, and it can be done right away as soon as you get him. So here we go. Roast these poor little guys. And Volcano is completely maxed. Let's move on. So, from the plaza where you fight Volcano, you just go through the archway to the next area. And you end up here. And look who's waiting for us. Oh, Livon, she's such a tsundere. That's okay. I guess you should kind of expect that from someone wearing those kinds of clothes. Alright, so this area is basically a safe zone. Well, relatively speaking, it looks like there are quite a few craters and stuff here. But the whole feel of this area, apart from the fact that there is the whole fantasy element of these gigantic spikes sticking out of the ground, which there's utterly no explanation for. It kind of gives the feel of a World War I trench warfare situation. And I'm kind of getting the impression that that was completely intentional on the part of the programmers. Because my first time through here, this whole battlefield just, for some reason, just made me really depressed. I hated it. Kind of get used to it, though. So this is our first encounter with those mechs I was referring to earlier. As you can see, they're kind of... Yeah, they're pretty weird looking. I have to say, though, I guess when I try and think about what an Irish afterlife battlefield mech would look like, I guess this does sort of fit. But at any rate, I've never really found these guys' id to be particularly useful, so I don't use it. I'm just catching them all. And actually, this ended up being a very long and drawn-out battle, so I ended up kind of cutting it short. I mean, really, you guys get the idea after the first couple of minutes. It's just more of this for the next 15 minutes or so. Killing all the enemies in the area, gathering up whatever items might be hidden here, that kind of thing. So I figured I'd spare you guys having to sit around and just sit through more monotony. This next guy is new. His name is actually... I think I might lock onto him here so you can see it. Alright, now there he is, okay. So yeah, his name is a slight mistranslation of the German word Brummbär, which is... It means basically a grouchy person, and it was also used as the designation for... forgive me, I'm going to have to edit out that massive sneeze. But yeah, Brummbär is a German word which means a grouchy person, and it was originally used as a designation for a, I believe it was a light tank that was used in World War II, I think. I'm not 100% on that, but it was the designation of some early 20th century, or former half of the 20th century, light armored vehicle. Oh, okay, so I think I might have gotten this guy off camera. I might have ended up cutting out the portion of footage where I got him. This is basically a better shield than the Kilmulis that we get in the Fairy Realm. He's basically an unlimited forward guard. It slowly drains MP, but it will block any attack that comes at you from whatever direction you're facing. So it's generally a much better shield than the Kilmulis. Now this guy is the tank enemy that I was referring to earlier, and he is the second mini-boss of Warcadia, and I must say he is considerably tougher. He gave me quite a difficult time my first playthrough, and I ended up having to fight him a few times to get the feel for how he works. Basically, with Gargantua, what you need to do is not get too close to him in any direction, because if you stand in front of him, he'll shoot cannon shells at you and blow you to bits. If you stand to the side of him, he'll use one of these little machine guns and stunlock you to death. And if you stand behind him, he'll basically charge backwards and run you over. So you really pretty much, there's a very narrow field of safe spots where you can stand. You kind of have to stand in his blind spot off to the corner of him, to the rear, and just keep hitting him with your strongest folks. Once you get the feel for that, though, he becomes a lot less challenging. And as you can see here, I'm doing fairly well. I can't remember if I guess I pulled this off without getting hit. So, an event id absorption, and now this very powerful, very cool-looking folk is all mine. And I guess here I was just trying to show off Patriot a little bit more. He is pretty cool looking. He's got this this weird Tengu face on his shield. Pretty cool. Isn't that expression supposed to be all flash and no substance? Isn't it? All flesh and no substance. That sounds like my ex-girlfriend. So basically, Levon has kind of told us that Ellen is on her way to Fort Avalon, which is the boss room in this area, with an army of fairies. Which I don't understand, because when you go there as Ellen, you don't have any army of fairies with you. It's just Ellen. They make Ellen do all the heavy lifting. They send her right in. Put her on point and make her fight the folklore. So I don't know what that's all about. And also, Levon has warned us, I think she warned us in the previous cutscene, actually, that the Fairy Lord is not quite the benevolent guy that he cracks himself up to be. So interesting stuff going on there. And then this fairy has given us a few little hints about how to deal with the folklore in this realm. So, let's go see what this hotly contested zone is all about. First of all, let's recover our HP. Because I'm almost dead. I don't even know how I lost all that HP. Oh, I guess because I cut out some karma releases before I ended up here. Alright, so... hotly contested zone, no kidding. Maybe they meant that literally. This whole place is surrounded by lava. So basically, I've just cut past a bunch of really tedious battles with wave after wave of little enemies. I now have to break a few fire elemental mystery stones, which Volcano takes care of for us without any trouble. Now I have to fight through some more waves of enemies, which, once again, I've spared you guys by cutting past. Now, killing all the enemies in this area gets us a few of these rewards. I could have just run by them, but these mystery stones would not have appeared. So we get a couple of life drops, and perhaps more importantly, we get the boss page from the Warcadia picture book. So let's have a look! So I guess this is just teaching us how to deal with the little minor enemies. I can't even really tell quite what's going on here. This is teaching us how to deal with Gargantua. It shows us that we were supposed to use one of the mechs, but Bargist actually ended up being much better for the job. Okay, so I guess this is the folklore. Looks like a giant war machine of some kind, and we're told that we need to first burn some part of him, and then send some soldiers after some part of him, and then have Boombea shoot some shells at him, and then destroy him with one of our mechs. So, let's go on in and see what's up. Now, I was a little bit disappointed with this fight. It had the makings to be really, really cool, but the execution of it, I don't know. Alright, well, let me explain. This thing is his fuel tank, this big cylindrical thing on his ass. And he's also got a ventral missile launcher, which is a huge, huge pain, because if you get hit by the first missile, you get stun locked. So basically what you're supposed to do is wait for him to use his jump attack. When he uses his jump attack, his fuel tank starts leaking, so you hit it with fire. You hit it with fire a few times, and it will explode. You can see it's kind of heating up here. And yeah, there you go. And it explodes, spilling fuel all over me. Freaking gross. So, next he hits me with a missile combo, which is a pain. So what we have to do now is destroy the armor protecting his legs. And we have to destroy this armor without getting 18 missiles in the face. And we also have to destroy the armor on each of his four legs, which really is, again, kind of tedious. So there's the first leg. And I believe you can destroy his missile launcher, which I think I'm trying to do here because I got sick of being shot with missiles. But I didn't succeed, so I can't remember. Here I just got, eventually, just lost my patience and got pissed off and hit Transcendence and just started unloading on him. And it did some good, because I think I got one or two of his legs, destroyed the armor on one or two of his legs. But Transcendence really doesn't last quite long enough, unfortunately. So, yeah, I succeeded in destroying the armor on at least one of his legs. Yeah, only one, sadly. But when you knock him down, that's your chance to start doing actual damage to him. When you see his id pop out, that means that you're making progress. He has a ton of hit points, though, so yeah, and that stupid missile launcher, really a pain. Of course, there I walked right into it. So, one leg remaining. Here I finally got on the ball with dodging his missiles. And once again, I completely dispensed with using the... I guess he can breathe fire too, which is definitely not a threat if you're behind him or to his side. But yeah, I pretty much dispensed with using Warcadia folks for this and just used the good ones that I already had. Bargust really... he's one of the best folks that you can get throughout the game. His usefulness does not decrease even in later realms. So what ended up happening here was the boss fell at an angle where I could not reach his head, and apparently in order to finish the job and actually kill him, you're supposed to hit a weak point inside his mouth. And of course he fell in such a way that I can't get at his head at all. You can't actually walk on the elevator that brings him up to the battlefield. So I just cut ahead to the point where I finally was able to get him to walk out of the elevator to an angle that allowed me to reach his weak spot. And after a slightly long id absorption event, he's dead. Oh yeah, and there goes his ventral gun. That figures.
Oh, I shouldn't have gotten out of bed today. Oh. Thank you.
Oh, hey, look, there's Ryan. No, wait. Don't you die on me. Oh, wait a minute. So the plot has just thickened considerably. We've learned that Harriet and Ryan were up to something 17 years ago, and that they appear to have had some kind of disagreement. Oh wait, what? See, look at this. What is this bullshit? Ellen defeated the folklore? She so did not. But once again, this is how they retcon both Keats and Ellen defeating the folklore, because when we come back here with Ellen, we're going to have to fight it again. And they'll probably tell us that Keats already came and beat it. So, back to Doolin Village we go. And I believe there may be one or two final cutscenes before the end of this chapter. I think here I went looking for Dr. Lester, but there's nothing here, and so I think I ended up going to his house. Yeah, I think that's where I went. Yup. But it's only his wife standing outside. She does give us some new dialogue, though. Alright, back to Harriet, I guess. I love how Keats is just so upfront with Harriet about that. Oh yeah, I went to the Netherworld and had a chat with Ryan. So, another major plot twist there, Harriet has just revealed that Ellen was apparently in the village 17 years ago, and Harriet had some kind of theory that she was apparently trying to test. It would seem to be that she was trying to see if it was actually Ellen. So, alright, well, thank you guys for joining me for this. Look forward to the next episode. It should be considerably shorter, because we've already covered a lot of stuff in Warcadia as it is. And I guess I'll see you guys next time.